good afternoon to all of you. I must speak loud because the mic is not working. I would like to welcome to Colombia Dr. Jorge Calvet, the CEO of Gamesa, Gabriel Alonso, the CEO of Horizon, and Juan Bo, the partner of Roland Berger Strategy Consultants in Beijing. It's an honor to have you with us. It's not at all frequent having so many people of so high quality on such an interesting topic, wind power. Wind power is a win-win. And now we had last week the World Energy Outlook of the International Energy Association, who projects for the next 25 years an increase in energy demand of 30%, the equivalent to 2 years of United States consumption. And what are the main features? Number one is China. China accounts for one-third of the increase in energy demand in the next 25 years. And the second is the increase in renewable energies. Wind power is a renewable energy, but it's a mature technology. And we'll have plenty of very interesting issues to debate here. How wind power is a mature technology, and that doesn't happen with regard to other renewable technologies, and how power is essential to build a sustainable portfolio of power production, and not least, how it is very likely that China will rapidly become the world leader in the wind energy. So with further ado, I would pass the floor to Dr. Jorge Calvet.
A wind turbine represents innovation, investments, and wealth creation. And it is a key element in the transition to a safe, reliable, zero-emission energy model, which helps reduce countries' energy dependence. A real alternative to which the world's economies are increasingly committed. A commitment shared by Gamesa, global leader in the wind energy market. Gamesa seeks to break new ground in reducing the cost of energy by enhancing the reliability and availability of its product and services portfolio, both present and future. With an ambitious plan to develop new families of its main onshore platforms and two new offshore platforms, making up one of the most complete and versatile portfolios for all types of winds and markets. With a clear commitment to innovation and technological development. Gamesa, an industrial company with a global reach, operating in markets with growth potential. A group that is constantly growing, driven by a strategy of expansion into new countries and customer segments. And a sales network with access to markets worldwide. Providing an integrated solution through operation and maintenance services that maximize the profitability of wind projects. And the development and sale of wind farms in countries on three continents. And an international team of more than 7,200 professionals meeting the needs of our customers. Gamesa is respectful of the environment and contributes to social and economic development. It's time for wind power. It's time for Gamesa.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank Manuel Pinho for his invitation to come here to Columbia University. And it's always a challenge for somebody who has studied at NYU to come up to Columbia. So I take that challenge on right here. The second thing I want to tell you is that I don't want you to think that I have not prepared for this, because I've written a speech. But as I was coming up to Columbia, I was thinking, well, why should I give a speech to a group of very intelligent young people? Because perhaps I could give you some insights as to what life of a CEO of one of the largest companies in the world is, and some of the challenges that I have to face, especially being at the School of International Public Affairs. I think that would be perhaps something more interesting that for me rather speaking to you out of a paper. So I decided to give you a speech, but not reading it. I hope you don't mind, Manuel. And I'm going to talk to you about three things which I think are absolutely key. One is to explain to you why Gamesa is truly the only Spanish global company that exists. Truly global, not international, truly global. Secondly, some of the challenges that we're facing in the market going forward, which is basically around the offshore market. And third, the biggest challenge that we face today, as I understand it, which is what about the regulatory frameworks that we have to live with? In other words, how do we deal with governments and politicians, which is quite a challenge, believe me. I want to start off by telling you that I've been in this job for 2 years, just over 2 years, and when I started off, Gamesa had 35% of its sales in Spain, and 35% of its sales with one company, which is Iberdrola, Spain's largest utility. Now, when you get into that sort of environment, you look at it, and being a former investment banker, which I don't brag about it these days because it's nothing to brag about, as you can imagine. I looked at it from a risk point of view, and I said, well, you know, we have too much risk in Spain and too much risk with one company. What should we do? No? And the first thing that I decided to do was, well, why don't we spread out our risk? And spreading out our risks meant at that time going abroad in a very big way, in a major way, and secondly, being able to reach different customers. So in 2 years, we have been able to achieve this in no small way. To give you an idea, as of right now, our sales in Spain are exactly zero. We don't sell anything in Spain, nothing. From 35 to nothing in 2 years is quite a challenge. And you would think, well, maybe they don't sell anything, and maybe they're selling less. Well, I have news for you. Not only are we selling the same as we were selling with Spain at the time, but even more. So about 25-30% more than 2 years ago. And secondly, with regard to our customer base, we have increased our customer base by 21 new customers in just in 2 years. And believe me, doing this in an industry like wind energy is no small feat. This is not like setting up a fixed bond trading operation where you can start on Monday. If it works on Wednesday, you carry on. If it doesn't work, you close it down. No, here you have to go into a country, understand what the wind regimes are, understand the regulatory environment, understand what the government wants, convince your customers or your potential customers that you have the right product, and then get on with it. So 21 new customers in 2 years is quite a feat. And again, it's the only listed company in Spain that is truly global. We have great companies like, for example, Telefonica, or the banks like Santander, or the utilities like Iberdrola, that are international companies, but they're not global. They're not in every single part of the world as we are. And this is very important because, in a way, our risk also as we have seen how the crisis has developed, has enabled us to limit our risk profile and not just being dependent on one country like Spain or another country like China. In China, we're going to be talking about it. China is a major market for us. It's about 25% of our market. We have 7 factories there, about 1,500 people. But we do not depend on the growth of China anymore. We're also entering into other emerging markets, like, for example, India, but also, importantly, for the last year, in Latin America, for example, in Brazil, Chile, Peru, et cetera, et cetera, even Honduras. So going beyond your geographical span and your customer base is absolutely critical. The second thing that we looked at was, well, I cannot only look for the next 3 years, which is, by the way, the length of our current business plan that ends up in 2013. I have to start thinking about Gamesa 3.0. And Gamesa 3.0 is something that's going to happen in 5 years from now, around 2015, 2016. And what does it mean? Well, it means that you have to enter into new markets, but entering into new markets is not just geographical markets or customers, as I was saying before. It's also about entering into new areas that are going to make you probably not only double but triple the size of your company. And this is the world, the fascinating world of offshore. offshore is going to be the next big step in this industry. Offshore, as you know, is, or maybe you don't know, but I can tell you, is the most humongous technical challenge that the utilities industry and certainly our company is going to have in the next couple of years. Just imagine that you have to put out the wind farm 50, 100 miles out in depths of about 40 to 50 meters, and the sea is not just, you know, like a glass. The sea moves, and it moves big time. When you have waves of 2 and 3 meters, which is not much for seamen, and you have to put up a turbine up there, you know, it's quite a challenge. So that is why I say that from a technological point of view, offshore is going to be the make or break of this industry, basically. I think it's quite a challenge. We're working on two opportunities here. One is a 5-megawatt turbine, the other one is a 7-megawatt turbine. Just to give you an idea of the size of these monsters, 5-megawatt turbine is as if you were to take a Boeing 777, and you have to put it with the waves on top of a 60 to 70 meter tower. That's how much it weighs. With engines, kerosene, crew, passengers, luggage, everything. And that has to work for the next 20 years. So you can imagine what this means from a technological point of view. And that's the 5. The 7 is even bigger. It's almost as if you were to put 2 Boeing 777s on top of a tower. No? So it's quite a challenge. The UK is going to be the first area where offshore is going to be developed in a big way, basically in Scotland and in some parts of southern England. Then you're going to have Germany, which has made a major policy change in the last couple of months after the Fukushima affair. As you know, they have decided not to continue with the nuclear power plants, and they're going to move everything basically into renewables and some gas. Then you have Holland, Belgium, and France, who are going to be moving in the same direction. So at the end of the day, and we're talking here 2030, 2035, ideally Europe would have a huge area which is called the North Sea with a supergrid that will be able to give renewable energy, wind energy, stable energy, because wind at sea is more stable than an onshore, will be able to give very large amounts or supply very large amounts of the demand that the European electricity grids will have. So to me, that is the next big challenge, and I urge you to follow it very closely if you're interested in renewable energy, because it's not only a technological feat, but it's going to have incredible consequences in the economics of Europe. And last but not least, I only have 15 minutes, then we can go into Q&A afterwards, because I would like to leave some time also for my colleagues. Last but not least, the biggest challenge that we have is dealing with governments, dealing with politicians. Now, I asked Manuel before, Dr. Pinho, if I should be politically correct, or if I could say some things about this. And frankly, I'm not going to be totally politically correct, okay? If you allow me, because I think that would be also of some interest to you. I think that, for example, in Europe, the lack of leadership is absolutely, you know, open, or everybody can see it. And obviously, when you have politicians thinking about the next election, that creates major hurdles for industry like ours, who have to look and plan for the long term as to what we're going to do with our industries. And obviously, this has a bearing on people. We cannot just sit there waiting what they want to decide to do and waiting for factories to be opened up or to be closed when they have to think about the next election. And the problem with the political regimes or democracies is that they are totally decoupled, if I may say so, from industrial processes and industrial decision-making processes. We cannot live off 4 years of political periods when we have to make investments of, say, 10, 15 years. And it just doesn't work. And unfortunately, no matter how much we tell politicians about this and we tell them, look, this is an industry that can create jobs, not in 6 months from now, but if you put in the right regulatory framework, we're going to be putting jobs on the spot the next day that we have that framework. That is a commitment that I have with different governments in Europe. That's a commitment, and I will talk about the States also here in the States, and basically anywhere in the world. But that is one problem. The second problem is that you do have also in the U.S. very major challenges that the U.S. government will have to face. What is the current government, and frankly, I don't see that going into a political year or election year next year, it's going to be an easy period for our industry. As a matter of fact, we're looking and we're contemplating, and I think that Gonzalo will tell you about it afterwards as well, we're contemplating that 2013, the renewable market, especially the wind market in the U.S., can fall off. In other words, that there will be no market whatsoever. Because the PTCs, the tax credits that you have on different forms, the tax grants, all of that could disappear if the politicians, both the on a bipartisan basis, they don't come up with an agreement. And frankly, as things stand today, I don't see that that is going to happen. So 2013, renewable energy in the States is going to be stopped. It's going to disappear. For how long, I have no idea. Now, there are other governments that have better ideas, like, for example, the Brazilian government. They have decided to have auctions for about 1,000 megawatts every year for the next 5-6 years. Makes a lot of sense. At least you can plan from an industrial point of view. You can talk to your customers. You have the Mexican government, which also has a long-term view about this. The Spanish government, as my grandmother used to say, they had very few ideas but very confused ones. So they didn't know what to do about this, and it shows no sales in Spain. The German government has better ideas, but to me, the government that has the best ideas, that has clarity as to what they want to do, is the Chinese government. The Chinese government has been consistent in saying, we have an energy need, and we have energy demand, and we're going to fulfill that energy demand with different forms of energy. It's not just going to be fossil fuels, it's not just going to be hydro, not nuclear, it's going to be a sum of all of those, and where wind is going to play a very significant role. We know from the latest five-year plan, which was enacted in April, which is the 12th five-year plan for the Chinese government, that they will have about 15,000 megawatts of wind energy coming our way for the next 5 years. Maybe a bit more, maybe a bit less, but you know that for sure, 15,000 megawatts per year you will have for the next 5 years. And this brings me to the last point that I want to make, which is something that I keep on talking to politicians and to regulators worldwide, which is every single country needs to understand and needs to have a long-term energy mix. They need to understand that the countries cannot, as I said before, operate on a short-term basis with regard to energy supply. They need to know exactly where energy is going to come from for the next 10 to 15 years, and hence the need for an energy mix that everything has to be contemplated. The most efficient ones, the ones that you have in your own country, the ones that you can import, if imports do make sense, or the ones that you can develop in your own country. So you need to have nuclear, you need to have hydro, you need to have gas, and yes, you need to have wind. Wind is a resource that is available to every single country in the world with more or less hours of operation. But the resource is there, and it has become very, very efficient. Just to give you last point, it has become so efficient that in the last auction in Brazil, which was held on August 16th of this year, for the first time, wind was cheaper than gas. And this is going to happen soon in Europe, and at some point it will happen also here in the States, which means that wind does not need subsidies anymore. And at this point, I will leave it. I could be talking about Gamesa and wind industry for the next 6 days, nonstop, but I think that I've been speaking for 50 minutes, which is my allotted time, so I will leave it now, and I hope you have some questions afterwards. Thank you.
Try to see if I can do something here. not checking my emails today, don't worry. I'm trying to see if I can do this. It's worth it, believe me.
I want to see this. This is the tornado.
This is a tornado that hit one of our wind farms last week. And you have a marvelous, some people have a marvelous hobby in this country of actually chasing tornadoes.
Yeah.
Oh, you cannot see it? Okay, so here you have. Okay, so this is a tornado, please. Tornado, this is Oklahoma, okay?
It's coming kind of more this way.
It's about 6 minutes. I'm not going to ask you guys to walk the entire. Let's go closer to the point where the wind farm was hit.
It's coming! Time is 4:24. Tornado on the ground, going right through the window farms. It's going on. It's on the mountain. It is on the mountain. It's in the windmill. Holy moly, it's in the windmill. It just, oh my gosh. The windmill is in it. Holy cow. The windmill just went survive a tornado.
Do you have the next turbine? It's working, eh? The turbine is spinning.
Can you hear it?
Take more of your time, but following Jorge's comments, we can survive a tornado. I don't know if we will be able to survive this political environment. Let me see if I have my PowerPoint here. Can you guys listen? Are you? Oh yeah. So let's. This is for. This is to press. Okay. So hopefully I will be. I don't know if I will be 15 minutes. Because I have about 30 slides and it should be about 50 seconds. I'm going to speak loud, so I don't need this. Hopefully you can actually see the video. Yeah. Okay, does it matter?
Yes.
There you go.
Okay.
Make sure to keep on.
Okay, that's fine. So I don't like to be behind a podium, I'm not hiding anything. So, let's start with my company, EDP Renewables, previously known as Horizon Wind Energy, now EDP Renewables North America. We are the third largest wind energy company in the US, third largest wind energy operator also in the world. We have 3,500 megawatts of installed capacity here in the US, 27 wind farms in 11 different states. We have invested more than $7 billion US dollars here in the US, about 300 employees, an EBITDA of 400 million, currently 316 megawatts under construction. If you go from here to Canada, right before you hit the border with Canada, we are building one of the largest wind farms here in New York as we speak. So my first message is that wind is a real business. So we are no longer a business of flip-flops and ponytails. Okay, that those times are no longer behind us, and we're a real business, real money, real investment. So my agenda is going to talk about three different things. Wind in the world and supporting schemes. I will try to be brief here. We'll all hear pretty much the same message. U.S. energy sector and how wind fits into that, into the U.S. energy sector and wind. What does the future hold for us? As you may have heard, wind energy is growing every year. We are seeing more and more installed capacity worldwide. But the reality is that the leadership on that, on the wind energy sector, has changed over the last decades. In the 90s, number one was Germany. They had the better scheme. Even if they didn't have a lot of wind resource, they had a very good supporting scheme. We saw a lot of wind energy being installed in Germany. In 2000s, US took over the first position. But as of last year, China is the new number one in the US. So USA has the best wind resource, much better than China, much better than China. But China is number one, so what's missing? When we look at the incentives, there are four different systems to incentivize wind energy. You have the US model, which is tax incentives and renewable energy credits. So you have tax incentives. For every megawatt hour you produce of electricity, you create an X amount of tax benefits, which means that yourself or somebody else can use it to offset any tax payments. Okay? The way it works is that normally wind energy companies are not strong enough to monetize and to take advantage of those tax benefits. So we do go to and bring in a third party, like a financial institution, a bank, or an insurance company, Wells Fargo, New York Life, JP Morgan Chase. Those type of companies will monetize, will pay us upfront, prepaid for those benefits that we plan to produce over the next 10 years, and then use those benefits for their own tax payments, to reduce their tax payments. Many of you have heard that GE doesn't pay taxes in the US. So you have heard that. Well, one of the reasons is that they do invest in tax credit businesses. Wind energy is one, gas, oil, drilling for oil and gas, it's another business where you have tax incentives. Then we have renewable portfolio standards. 29 states have renewable portfolio standards, which means that in those states, the utilities are required to acquire a percentage of their energy sales from renewable energy sources. And the percentage normally goes up. It starts low and goes up all the way to 2020, 2030. Normally those references have no floor. If supply is over demand, they tend to go to $0 per megawatt hour. And if supply is way below demand, there's normally a cap which is equal to the penalty the utilities will have to pay if they don't comply with the requirement. I hope it makes economic sense. Then the feed-in tariff system. It's a fixed price for a long-term period of time, 15, 20 years. Why long-term? This is a very intensive capital investment. All the money is put up front. Our variable costs are minimal because our fuel is free. Okay? You might remember that throughout my conversation. Countries that have a feed-in tariff system: Portugal in the first stages, France, and Ontario in Canada. Third system, competitive tender. Either the generation license, in those countries where you have a fixed price, then they will have competitive processes to award the licenses to build projects, or in those countries where the price is floating, then they will have competitive tenders, as Jorge talked about Brazil, where you would have a long-term contract with a fixed price after a competitive process. And there you have Portugal. They did that. In exchange of getting the generation licenses, what they were asking for is industrial investment. They wanted the equipment or different parts of the equipment being produced in Portugal and create jobs in Portugal. Same in what you have in Brazil with contracts, you have in Ontario, in Quebec, for example, similar to the Portuguese model. And then pool plus premium plus green certificates. For example, in those cases, you have a premium over the pool price, or you have a green certificate that has a fixed price, or it's priced based on the market conditions. In those cases, also, there is a floor and a cap. Countries with this system, pool plus premium, Spain is a great example. Pool plus renewable energy credits, Poland, Romania are also good examples. So does US have the right support in the scheme? Well, when we look at the RPS, and I talked to, remember I said two components, the state RPS, and I said about the tax incentives. When we look at the state RPSs, it looks like based on those RPS and the demand, that is the demand gap, or the supply gap, then we believe that we should see around 5 to 6 gigawatts of installed capacity moving forward. Good news is that wind energy is not only installed in those states, 29 states where you have an RPS, for two reasons. One, because normally those states do not demand the wind to come immediately from within the state. They do allow for regional delivery of electricity. So you can have an RPS in Illinois, but have a project in Iowa and deliver the electricity to Illinois and comply with the LPS. Second, because not all states, not there are states without any RPS that have seen wind development. Why? Because it's extreme, the resource is extremely strong and the economics make sense by themselves. Examples, Oklahoma, Nebraska. There's not an RPS, there's not a demand, a requirement to acquire a percentage of wind energy, but the utilities are doing so because it makes economic sense for their customers. And the local regulators, the state regulators, are allowing those long-term contracts with fixed prices for 20, 25 years to become part of the rate base. So for the utility, it's a pass-through. The cost of that contract goes directly into their consumer space. Then we talk about tax incentives. The problem of the tax incentive is it's a very short-term incentive. Once you qualify for it, you have it for 10 years. The problem is that the tax incentives are available for periods of 2-3 years, which is completely impossible to plan your business beyond 2 years with this type of incentives. Jorge was talking about manufacturing activities. Think about investment activities. I mean, once again, if you build a 100 megawatt wind farm, $200 million, all of that goes day one. So you need to make sure that your incentives scheme is available for your project before you make that type of investment. You need to have also long-term contract with certainty on your revenue line. So in those years where PTCs last, you can see how low the market went. And right now, PTCs are set to expire at the end of 2004. And if they are not renewed, pipeline for a few years to the wind energy sector. We are very close to grid parity in many parts of this country. We'll talk about that. But right now, we're still a few inches close to that situation. Right now, we still need PTCs. So two areas of improvement when I look at the existing regulatory scheme in the US. I think it would make more sense to have a federal renewable portfolio standard instead of a state, 29 states having creating regional markets. It's more efficient if you have a federal one. Let me give you one example. Let's assume that we all believe, and everyone in this country believes that our kids should, well, my kids, I don't think many people have kids here, but. Our kids in the U.S. should drink a glass of orange juice every morning. It's healthy, it makes them awaken, it makes them will get better grades at school. That's the right way to do it. But instead of having a federal policy requiring that, you would have different states requiring that and pushing for regional demand for orange, growing oranges, correct? So what would happen is that you would have in Florida parents paying 50 cents for a glass of orange juice. Kids will be very happy, very tasty, very nice orange juice. And then you will have kids in North Dakota, their parents, paying $50 for a glass of orange juice, and more than likely the students having very bad grades, they will spend half of the morning in the restroom, correct? Because I don't think the orange juice of North Dakota will be really, really tasty. So that's what's a little bit of what's happening right now in the US. You have regional markets for renewable energy credits, but the best way, the most efficient way to do this is through a federal policy, which we don't have. And then liquidity on tax incentives. Right now, I can monetize those tax incentives, but in order to monetize them, I have to go to a set of clients, institutional investors. I mentioned those, banks, insurance companies. Other energy industries like gas pipeline, oil drilling activities, they have master liability partnerships, which allow individuals with tax base to get together under a master liability partnership and invest in the wind farm and have those tax benefits flow individually together. That opens up a huge benefit in terms of liquidity to the market. It reduces the cost of monetizing these tax incentives. It allows us also to sell our electricity cheaper. So I think, yes, the system is a good system. It could be improved, as it say. I mean, the scheme is a good scheme, so it could be improved, but the system, the energy system, is not fully good. We are seeing right now in many places of this country where wind is being curtailed. And by curtailed means that there is wind, but we are being asked to stop producing electricity. And when we know that wind has zero marginal cost, or minimal marginal cost, because the wind is free, then if a system is curtailing the source of electricity that has zero marginal cost, but keeping running and producing electricity those that have a much higher marginal cost, then by nature the system is inefficient. Okay? So I think that Also, the reality of the U.S. is there is not one single market. There are many energy markets, and we can talk about that also. So when I talk about the U.S. energy sector and how wind fits into that sector, if we look at the last years, this has been a game of wind and gas. Those two sources, primarily gas, but also the big amount of wind that has been installed, and that has been primarily the growth of new capacity being installed in the U.S., which has led to a decrease, of course, of coal market share by minus 6.5%. Gas went up by 6.8% and wind by 1.5%. We are still a small player. So the key question is gas and wind, wind and gas. Is this the right direction for the energy sector in the U.S.? So one of the issues that I think Jorge talked about, which I think is extremely important, is the lack of long-term vision that this country is suffering right now. When we look at last century, there were key decisions made. There was a vision as to where the energy sector in the U.S. wanted to go. This country knew they wanted deregulation, they wanted competitive markets, you wanted to support nuclear energy, you wanted to support sustainable electricity. EPA was approved in the 70s by Nixon. So there was long-term visibility. Currently, that long-term visibility, if it exists, is not able to execute. And I think it does exist. I do think President Obama has a vision. Secretary of Energy too, they have a vision as to where they want the energy sector to go. However, as they say, vision without execution equals to hallucination, right? So it's nothing, it's worthless. And that's the reality right now. So when I look at long-term policies, in my opinion, this country needs long-term policy with five goals in mind. Affordability, of course, we need to go to and tackle and try to target the cheapest energy electricity possible. The energy sector is a sector that has internal and external impacts to a given country. It's not only about electricity, it's about the ability to be a competitive source of equipment, a competitive source of services. So price matters. But not only price, near-term, certainty matters, and certainty price-wise. If you only support the cheap electricity today, you may be making the wrong decision for the future. There has to be a balance between the cheapest source today and the source that provides you with price certainty over the next 20, 25 years. Reliability. You need to make sure that there is a reliable energy mix, that the system, the infrastructure is in place to keep providing electricity. And you would think, okay, that's not a big deal. Well, it is a big deal. Right now, the energy sector primarily has four, the cost structure of electricity has four components. Energy capacity, environmental benefits, and flexibility. The first two ones are properly priced. There are fair rules, transparent rules in many markets in this country, and they are properly priced. What's happening is that a lot of players are entering the industry and basing their business proposition on those two components, disregarding the other two. That's why, for example, the FERC and the National Berkeley Lab issued a report last year highlighting that over the last 10 years, the grid robustness in the U.S. has suffered because flexibility and reliability is not properly priced right now in the energy markets in the U.S. Sustainability, I think it is important. You have to have a sustainable. There are external costs to wind, to producing and consuming electricity, and you have to take those into consideration. And finally, energy independence. I think this should be an option of any country that can afford it. It shouldn't be an obligation. But as a country, I think the U.S. has the resources, and you should build the optionality to be energy independent when required. The amount of wealth displaced in this country is huge because of this. And that may make sense for economic reasons in a given time. But I think you have to build the optionality to make sure that if you have to switch, you can switch, because the resources are here. And I'm not talking about wind energy, solar. Once again, I do believe in wind, I do believe in solar, I do believe we need more than that. This is not, we are not going to be running our country or any country based on wind and solar only. So that you have more than wind and solar, you have gas, you have oil, and you have to build the optionality. The problem is the lack of vision, right? Lack of, as Seneca said, that if a man doesn't know which harbor he seeks, no wind is the right wind. Doesn't matter where you're heading. You're playing by ear, which is what's happening right now with short-term policies. So this is creating a lot of uncertainty. And uncertainty is exactly where businessmen don't want to work. We don't like uncertainty, right? Everyone likes certainty, but for business purposes, you do want certainty. And we have a ton of uncertainty right now in the U.S. EPA, fully supported by the Supreme Court since the 70s, now being completely challenged. Clean energy standard, the federal energy standard. Several drafts of bills were drafted, none have passed. I don't think it will go anywhere. The RPS, it's a nice story. The state RPS, we are seeing them. New ones have been approved. Even existing ones have been increased, like in California, Iowa, Colorado, Minnesota. CO2 legislation, forget about it. It's just a dream, okay? No, it's not gonna happen. California has it. They need to now team up with Quebec, Ontario, and BC, because no one is paying attention to them here in the US. But finally, one thing that is extremely certain is public support to this clean energy. I think the public awareness and the support is there, and it's there on both aisles. 80% of the wind installed in the US is in Republican districts. 68% of the manufacturing jobs related to wind are located in Republican districts. This is not a Democrat discussion. This is a bipartisan issue. So doing nothing is the worst path forward, correct? As Professor Sin said once, you can't be neutral in a moving train. You cannot. So power demand. This is another reality, another challenge. This is a good challenge, even if it doesn't sound so. When you have an economy in recession, less economic activity, less demand for electricity. And we sell electricity. Okay? It's green, brown, blue, whatever you put the color, but it's electricity at the end. We are not selling megawatts. Jorge sells equipment, turbine, I am selling electricity. So if the market is not there, I don't have a business case. I don't have a business proposition. And the electricity market is a big pie with several slices. Right now, as you saw, the wind slice is 1.2%. It's no more than that. So our ability to make that slice bigger is to get the pie getting bigger. That's how we have been growing as an industry. Every time it gets bigger, we get a bigger component, a big chunk of that increase in the pie. Why? Because we are modular. We can build 50 megawatts, 100 megawatts, 20 megawatts. With gas, coal, and other plants, you need to make bigger plants. Second, why? Because our time to market is very fast. If you need a 100 megawatt wind farm, in 6 months you'll have a 100 megawatt wind farm up and running. And so a lot of utilities don't need 1,000 megawatts. They need 50 megawatts there, 100 megawatts here, 200 megawatts there. We provide that level of flexibility and time to market. But the reality is that we are not immune to the economy and the energy sector. We are not. This is good news, in my opinion. Okay? This is good news because it proves that we are part of the energy sector. And when the energy sector goes down, we are affected. So let's talk about the last point, wind. What does the future hold for wind? Five main external value drivers, three of which are policy contingent, tax credits, accelerated depreciation, renewable energy credit prices based on RPS. Two that are not, the cost, reduced electricity, and the power prices in the market. My strong belief is that the future of our industry relies on our ability to play by the market rules, okay? To focus our efforts on those first two components. Our ability to produce cheaper and cheaper, our ability to deal with the dynamics of power markets. But we need fairness and transparency. And reality is today that fairness and transparency doesn't exist. There's too much money at stake, big corporations at stake, and changing the rules is not simple. It's extremely complicated. Then, when we talk about gas prices. Well, the reality is that right now, sale gas is affecting our ability to be competitive. As you may have heard, sale gas is a cheap source of gas right now. And not only that, 300,000 megawatts of gas plants were installed between 1995 and 2005. There was a boom in the gas business. Most of those plants are working at an average of 3,000 hours. So actually, my competitor is not the cost of a new gas plant. My competitor is the marginal cost of that incremental hour of production of an existing gas plant. Does it make sense? So how do you get from 3,000 to 4,000 hours? The cost of increasing those 1,000 hours of production of an existing gas plant is my competitor. It's not a new CCGT. I am beating a new CCGT, no question about it. But when I am competing against that a plant that is already completely written off or fully depreciated, where the marginal cost is primarily the gas component of it, that's when I have the challenge. Okay? And that's a real challenge, and we need to acknowledge it. That is not going to happen forever, because it's not that those all those plants can go from 3,000 to 8,760. Gas pipelines are not completely abundant. There is also a shortage of gas pipelines and gas supply, even if the gas is underground. Okay? But that's a reality. The reality is also that people are forecasting that gas is going to take over this, the growth on the energy sector over the next 20 years. But I do hope that we have memory. And we remember the days when gas was not at $4. It was much higher than that. We have in mind that we had big corporations entering into the shale gas business. Chevron, BP, Shell, Exxon. Those companies are investing hundreds of billions of dollars. And those corporations are not here because they believe that gas is going to be at $4 20 years from today. So many see shale gas as a problem for wind. I see it as a challenge. I see it as an opportunity, because it's pushing us, it's pushing the turbine suppliers to get lower and lower on the cost curve of producing electricity, and we are going in the right direction. We have made significant progress. However, watch out for those prophets that believe that we are in the middle of a shale gas revolution, because as Carlos Fuentes, a very famous Mexican writer, said once, revolutions are achieved by regular people, not saints, and they always end up creating a new privileged class. Okay? So we need to be, but I think energy diversification in this, in an energy industry is key. So when we look at ourselves, and I'm about to finish, from our side, as I was saying, we need to reduce the cost of producing electricity. And we are achieving that. We are working that from an efficiency standpoint. When I came to this country, and I actually was working in Gamesa in 2002, we built the first utility scale wind farm. We installed that wind farm with the best technology available. 27% was the net capacity factor of that project. In 2007, Horizon, now EDPR Renewables, built the largest wind farm in Illinois. 33% net capacity factor, the best technology available. It was worse wind resource than the previous one. Normally, like in any other business, the first that shows up gets the best wind resource. Last year, we built the project, 40% net capacity factor. All of that is technology improvement that is happening as we speak, and this is not coming at a higher cost factor. So the cost of turbines are coming down, the technology is certainly improving. And we have a fundamental advantage. Wind is free. That's a huge advantage. And we don't transform, we don't extract, we don't burn any element to produce our electricity. We do need to acknowledge that wind is intermittent. So if you ask me, right now I think wind has to be focused on getting affordable, cheap source of electricity, but we are intermittent. We are not there every time you need a shower or you need to watch TV. So we need, from a technology standpoint, not only we need to work now on how to reduce the cost of electricity and get to grid parity, we need to work on how to deal with intermittency. And we can deal in different ways. We can deal with the current energy structures. We are, for example, selling wind from a wind farm from Iowa all the way to Tennessee. And instead of delivering, taking that electricity, we're actually selling the electricity in Iowa and buying the same block of electricity in Tennessee, adding the renewable energy credits and delivering a block of electricity to the utility who doesn't deal with intermittency. I take that risk on my side. Okay, I'm working with the structures and the ancillary services available in the market. The other idea is the storage, of course. Now the key question is, where should the storage happen? Should it happen at the generation unit level, or should it happen at the consumer's level? I personally believe it should happen where the electricity is consumed. That's the purpose of electricity, correct? You produce it to be consumed. The next one is electric vehicles. That can be a big game changer. We can get the electric vehicles as a source to flatten the demand of electricity in the U.S., as it would allow to increase the penetration of wind in the system, because we are, once again, an intermittent source of energy. We shouldn't be hiding. We should work towards dealing with that issue. Conclusion, wind is not immune to end the economy. U.S. needs a long-term policy. Who is up to task? I do think we have a president that likes the idea. When I watch the Republican debates, I don't see a lot of interest in dealing with this situation, honestly, in this environment. Shale gas revolution. History matters. Watch out with short memory and watch out with profits. I don't think neither Chevron nor Exxon nor BP or Shell are saints. Wind is free, and our success relies on our hands. Thank you.
Sorry for keeping you waiting. It seems that my slide made in China does not comply to US technology standard. Bear me with a few minutes, I bring my laptop.
Yeah, it will go anywhere. The RPS is a nice story. The state RPS, we are seeing them. New ones have been approved. Even existing ones have been increased, like in California, Iowa, Colorado, Minnesota. CO2 legislation, forget about it. It's just a dream, okay? No, it's not gonna happen. California has it. They need to now team up with Quebec, Ontario, and BC because no one is paying attention to them here in the US. But finally, one thing that is extremely certain is public support to this wind energy. I think the public awareness and the support is there, and it's there on both aisles. 80% of the wind installed in the US is in Republican districts. 68% or the manufacturing jobs related to wind are located in Republican districts. This is not a Democrat discussion. This is a bipartisan issue. So doing nothing is the worst path forward, correct? As Professor Sin said once, you can't be neutral in a moving train. You cannot. So power demand. This is another reality, another challenge. This is a good challenge, even if it doesn't sound so. When you have an economy in recession, less economic activity, less demand for electricity. And we sell electricity, okay? It's green, brown, blue, whatever, you put the color, but it's electricity at the end. We are not selling megawatts. Jorge sells equipment, turbine, I am selling electricity. So if the market is not there, I don't have a business case. I don't have a business proposition. And the electricity market is a big pie with several slices. Right now, as you saw, the wind slice is 1.2%, it's no more than that. So our ability to make that slice bigger is to get the pie getting bigger. That's how we have been growing as an industry. Every time it gets bigger, we get the bigger component, a big chunk of that increase in the pie. Why? Because we are modular. We can build 50 megawatts, 100 megawatts, 20 megawatts. With gas, coal, and other plants, you need to make bigger plants. Second, why? Because our time to market is very fast. If you need a 100 megawatt wind farm, in 6 months you have a 100 megawatt wind farm up and running. So a lot of utilities don't need 1,000 megawatts. They need 50 megawatts there, 100 megawatts here, 200 megawatts there. We provide that level of flexibility and time to market. But the reality is that we are not immune to the economy and the energy sector. We are not. This is good news, in my opinion. Okay? This is good news because it proves that we are part of the energy sector. And when the energy sector goes down, we are affected. So let's talk about the last point, wind. What does the future hold for wind? Five main external value drivers, three of which are policy contingent, tax credits, accelerated depreciation, renewable energy credit prices based on RPS, two that are now, the cost to produce electricity and the power prices in the market. My strong belief is that the future of our industry relies on our ability to play by the market rules, okay? To focus our efforts on those first two components, our ability to produce cheaper and cheaper, our ability to deal with the dynamics of power markets. But we need fairness and transparency, and reality is today that fairness and transparency doesn't exist. There's too much money at stake, big corporations at stake, and changing the rules is not simple. It's extremely complicated. Then, when we talk about gas prices, well, the reality is that right now, shale gas is affecting our ability to be competitive. As you may have heard, shale gas is a cheap source of gas right now. And not only that, 300,000 megawatts of gas plants were installed between 1995 and 2005. There was a boom in the gas business. Most of those plants are working at an average of 3,000 hours. So actually, my competitor is not the cost of a new gas plant. My competitor is the marginal cost of that incremental hour of production of an existing gas plant. Does it make sense? So how do you get from 3,000 to 4,000 hours? The cost of increasing those 1,000 hours of production of an existing gas plant is my competitor. It's not a new CCGT. I am beating a new CCGT, no question about it. But when I am competing against that plant that is already completely written off or fully depreciated, where the marginal cost is primarily the gas component of it, that's when I have a challenge. Okay? And that's a real challenge, and we need to acknowledge it. That is not going to happen forever, because it's not that all those plants can go from 3,000 to 8,760. Gas pipelines are not completely abundant. There is also a shortage of gas pipelines and gas supply, even if the gas is underground. Okay? But that's a reality. The reality is also that people are forecasting that gas is going to take over the growth on the energy sector over the next 20 years. But I do hope that we have memory. And we remember the days when gas was not at $4. It was much higher than that. We have in mind that we had big corporations entering into the shale gas business. Chevron, BP, Shell, Exxon, those companies are investing hundreds of billions of dollars. And those corporations are not here because they believe that gas is going to be at $4 20 years from today. So many see shale gas as a problem for wind. I see it as a challenge. I see it as an opportunity, because it's pushing us, it's pushing the turbine suppliers to get lower and lower on the cost curve of producing electricity. And we are going in the right direction. We have made significant progress. However, watch out for those prophets that believe that we are in the middle of the shale gas revolution, because as Carlos Fuentes, a very famous Mexican writer, said once, revolutions are achieved by regular people, not saints, and they always end up creating a new privileged class. Okay? So we need to be, but I think energy diversification in an energy industry is key. So when we look at ourselves, and I'm about to finish, from our side, as I was saying, we need to reduce the cost of producing electricity. And we are achieving that. We are working that from an efficiency standpoint. When I came to this country, and I actually was working in Gamesa in 2002, we built the first utility-scale wind farm. We installed that wind farm with the best technology available. 27% was the net capacity factor of that project. In 2007, Horizon, now EDPR Renewables, built the largest wind farm in Illinois, 33%. Net capacity factor, the best technology available. It was worse wind resource than the previous one. Normally, like in any other business, the first that shows up gets the best wind resource. Last year, we built the project 40% net capacity factor. All of that is technology improvement that is happening as we speak, and this is not coming at a higher cost factor. So the cost of turbines are coming down, the technology is certainly improving. And we have a fundamental advantage. Wind is free. That's a huge advantage. And we don't transform, we don't extract, we don't burn any element to produce our electricity. We do need to acknowledge that wind is intermittent. So if you ask me, Right now, I think wind has to be focused on getting affordable, cheap source of electricity, but we are intermittent. We are not there every time you need a shower or you need to watch TV. So we need, from a technology standpoint, not only we need to work now on how to reduce the cost of electricity and get to grid parity, we need to work on how to deal with intermittency. And we can deal in different ways. We can deal with the current energy structures. We are, for example, selling wind from a wind farm from Iowa all the way to Tennessee. And instead of delivering, taking that electricity, we're actually selling the electricity in Iowa and buying the same block of electricity in Tennessee, adding the renewable energy credits and delivering a block of electricity to the utility who doesn't deal with intermittency. I take that risk on my side. They are working with the structures and the ancillary services available in the market. The other idea is the storage, of course. Now, the key question is where should the storage happen? Should it happen at the generation unit level or should it happen at the consumer's level? I personally believe it should happen where the electricity is consumed. That's the purpose of electricity production. You produce it to be consumed. The next one is electric vehicles. That can be a big game changer. We can get the electric vehicles as a source to flatten the demand of electricity in the U.S. as it would allow to increase the penetration of wind in the system because we are, once again, an intermittent source of energy. It shouldn't be hiding. We should work towards dealing with that issue. Conclusion, wind is not immune to the economy. U.S. needs a long-term policy. Who is up to task? I do think we have a president that likes the idea. When I watch the Republican debates, I don't see a lot of interest in dealing with this situation, honestly, in this environment. Shale gas revolution, history matters. Watch out with short memory and watch out with profits. I don't think neither Chevron nor Exxon nor BP or Shell are saints. Wind is free, and our success relies in our hands. Thank you.
Sorry for keeping you waiting. It seems that my slide made in China does not comply to US technology standard. Bear me with a few minutes, I bring my laptop.
Program Director for the Energy Program here at SIPA. So I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience. And thank you both for that excellent comments and views. So we're just going to use the time while he's getting his laptop set up to take a few questions. And one of the things I wanted to ask you both is that you both paint a very optimistic picture about wind energy technology in terms of the technology, the potential, the customer demand, et cetera. So what kind of risks, what are your biggest risks? You mentioned intermittency. You mentioned long-term policy, lack of long-term policy. What do you see as sort of the biggest risks for your business?
Well, I would Well, obviously, what I'm going to say, you would expect me to say, which is that I do believe that technology is already not mature, because technology is never mature. We develop about 120 patents every year. So there's a lot of new R&D stuff coming our way, no? But I do firmly believe that technology, and obviously Gamesa is at the forefront of technology. So to me, technology is not an issue. You do have to invest in R&D, certainly. Now, for example, we're looking into how to apply nanotechnology into certain components, and we're doing that out of Singapore, for example. So I don't see that as a challenge. I mean, it's a technological challenge, but we're working on it, so I don't think that that is a major issue. I think, as I said before, we do need to have long-term policies to have long-term plans, so that we can deliver to our customers, as Gabriel was saying before, the lowest cost of energy possible. And to me, that is the biggest challenge that we have, because it's not something that we can control. We can control our R&D budgets. We can control whatever we want to do in R&D. And Gabriel was also mentioning before about storage. Storage for us is a big, big thing. And I think that the holy grail of this industry is going to be in the storage area. So all these technical things, all the commercial activities, all the manufacturing improvements that we can do, that is in our hands, and obviously we're working very hard in keeping those under control and focusing very much on them. Something that we cannot have under control, no matter how much, you know, we visit DC or we go to London or whatever, that is what worries me quite a lot, and that is, I think, the biggest challenge that we have.
From my side, I think that technology is the big advantage of our sector, in the sense that, as I was explaining before, we are competing, wind is competing from a technology standpoint against gas prices right now. And we'll see where gas prices will go in the future, but the fact that they are so cheap right now are encouraging and pushing us to develop technology quickly and go down on the cost curve very quickly. Right now, the companies are building taller towers. The taller you go, normally the better the wind resource. And they're also working on longer blades, so to speak, because the longer the blade, the more electricity you produce with the same amount of wind resource. So, and it is fascinating to see how much the technology is evolving, because 5 years ago, 6 years ago, everyone thought that in order to get 40% net capacity factors, or even 50% net capacity factors, you had to build big transmission lines from Nebraska, North, South Dakota, from Oklahoma, all the way to Tennessee, to Indiana, or to the load center, to Chicago. But the reality is that technology is moving much faster than transmission and grid infrastructure development. It's very complicated to develop and permit grid infrastructure here. So the actual gap of the high wind resource of Oklahoma with the lower, still there, but lower wind resource of Indiana or Illinois is being bridged by technology evolution, not by transmission lines. You are getting to the same economics now by virtue of developing new transmission lines, by virtue of developing new technology and not new transmission lines, which I find it very interesting, and improve how regulation, a lot of regulation in this case, is actually encouraging technology in the right way. The industry couldn't wait for new transmission lines to be permitted, because they are not permitted at federal level, they are permitted at state level, so you have very many, many conflicting interests when you cross many states. So the industry had to move quickly, and it's working in the right direction. Once again, we are seeing cost of electricity has gone, or produced from wind has gone down by about 20-30% over the last 3 years.
And how would you characterize that as a risk?
How do I characterize as a risk? I think that in terms of the sector, I would say that I think Jorge said, we are not a mature technology. Normally, technology is not mature enough. But a lot of the knowledge that is being implemented into wind, it's already existing in other sectors. I mean, a lot of the technology that you use to design blades comes from the aeronautical sector. The availability levels that we currently have in our fleet are 98%. I mean, We are talking about very high availability levels. So I would not consider our technology that we have a big risk. I mean, these turbines are complex. The controls are the biggest element or risk. But they are, in general, from a mechanical standpoint, simple compared to other energy sources, correct? So I don't think that our biggest risk right now is regulation and lack of vision politically.
So we'll take one question from the floor while they or are you ready to go?
Can I ask my question? Because I want him to hear it.
Sure.
Sorry. My name is Alice Labrie, and I'm speaking sort of from memory, but I just read, I think, that on the highway to Palm Springs in California, there were some windmills, and they dismantled them because of the noise. And frankly, I don't know where you're placing them, but I don't think if I had a home, I'd want to be living near a wind energy thing. So what are some of the downsides that are and the risks that are being raised, Mr. Calvet?
Well, I wasn't sure that that wasn't a question for me, but I will try to answer it.
I can answer it if you want. I can
do it. Before you do, give your point of view for consumers. From a technology point of view, if I may say so, there are two things that you have to bear in mind. One, and I'm sure that Gabriel will give you more detail, there is strict regulation as to how close to any living area you can set up wind farms. That's point one. And the second thing is that as we talk about technology, yes, we're working very hard at making sure that the aerodynamics of the blade do contemplate always the lowest noise levels possible. Okay, so this is an ongoing issue. I think that we have come down significantly in terms of noise levels, and there's nothing you can do to avoid 100% noise. But I think that we have come a very long way, and obviously, as I say, we keep on talking about in our R&D department as to how to bring it down even further.
Two clarifications. One is the wind farms in Palm, the wind turbines of Palm Springs were installed in the 80s. They are more like fans than anything else. That technology is no longer in place. I mean, we are way beyond that technology. Right now, when you permit a project, you have to place those turbines at a distance, at a several many thousand feet, around 1,000 feet, depending on the state, from houses. We are talking about normally a regulation that goes from 45 to 50 decibels. That that's the level of noise that you can have in a house. 45 to 50 decibels is the noise of your refrigerator in your kitchen. That's pretty much what you're talking outside your house. Once you get inside, so if we were to measure the noise as you get outside your house, that's the level that we have to comply with. So I think it's pretty strict level. Regarding noise and somebody's willingness to live near a house with a turbine that would make some that level of noise, I remember when we developed the first wind farm with Gamesa, actually in Illinois. After building that project, we were planning to develop more projects. We were developing more projects, and we took one of our landowners to a public hearing in Wisconsin, where we were developing another project. And so we let him go there because the landowners there wanted, and the public officials wanted to talk to a landowner to see what was it like to live around a turbine. And so one of the questions was very clear: what is the noise level? Do these turbines make noise? And he went up and said, yes, they make a lot of noise. And I was like, oh my goodness. And he said, what level of noise? It's clunk, clunk, clunk. What's that noise? That's the coins in my bank account every time the blades are turning. So, I mean, we need to be mindful of the level of noise we're talking about, but as one landowner told me, my own pigs don't stink, okay? So, I mean, we are talking about very strict noise levels, 45 to 50 decibels. We're talking outside the house. So we're talking about right now, this is not, as far as we know, it's not an issue.
Okay, thanks for that. We took a couple of questions. And out of respect for Mr. Liu, we'd like to hear your thoughts on wind energy in China and questions that were not answered in the last round. That was not expected questions. So we will have questions at the end.
Okay, sorry for keeping you waiting. I have about 30 slides. I will try to go through the slides as quickly as I can. My presentation will be in four main aspects. First, I'd like to share with you about the tremendous growth opportunities in China wind energy. Second, as Jorge mentioned, that I'd like to share with you about offshore wind development and also the prospects in China. Third, I will cover some recent hot topics about Chinese renewable energy players heading into international markets. Last, I will quickly go through some of the challenges and also the current upgrading systems that the China government and also Chinese wind players are going through. So this slide, as Jorge and also Gabriel has previously mentioned before, I would not go through this slide. I just give you another fact that you may not know, that actually China is not only ranking number one in wind, it's also ranking number one in the ongoing nuclear projects. And China is now representing about 60% of ongoing nuclear projects worldwide. So you can see last year China has overtaken US as the number one market worldwide. And the Chinese wind market is not only growing fast than other global markets. You can see on the left-hand side of this slide, the annual growth rate of this market was pretty about 500% compared with the 24% in the other market in the past several years. But also, the market was developed much faster than the central government originally planned. In China, we have a central government body called NDRC, National Development and Reform Committee, plus eight other ministries that are jointly responsible for formulating the policies for developing renewable energy in China. But the provincial development reform committee, I mean the provincial governments, also have huge impact on the development of renewable energy in their certain regions. You can see that the actual wind market development was about four times the original plan formulated by Chinese central government. Talking about the growth driver for the tremendous growth of Chinese wind energy in the past several years, we think that the continuously decreasing wind power cost and also the reliable subsidies by either central government or provincial government are the two most important growth drivers for the tremendous growth in this market. You can see, as we predict that in 2015, the wind power would be cost competitive with gas and also coal. You may know that China is a country still heavily reliant on coal. In last year, about 80 to 85% of Chinese energy was still generated by coal. And the Chinese central government has promised to reduce the energy emission by around 20% by 2020. That has put a lot of effort on Chinese government to continuously develop renewable energy by reducing the dependency on coal. And also, according to the latest National Wind Development Plan that the Chinese government. I mean, China National Energy Administration just announced about a month ago, by 2050, the country will target a total installed capacity about 1,000 gigawatt. So probably U.S., the country, you do not have the plan for the next four decades, but the country like China have a very clear energy roadmap for next decade, next two decades, and also all the way to 2050. And the NEA, National Energy and Nutrition, also have pretty clear three development stages for the next decade, all the way to 2030, and also by the middle of this century. And also we have some estimate investment based upon the forecast, forward-looking estimate investment per unit. So that would be about a $2,000 billion investment in next four decades, implying a vast, tremendous market opportunities in the market. Now I'm going to quickly talk about the offshore wind development in China. Up till now, China has only one completed offshore wind project that is very close to Shanghai. The offshore wind project was run by Datang, one of the top five Chinese power generation companies. The turbine was supplied by Sinovel. Sinovel is China's largest, probably today is the largest, one of the largest, one of the world's largest wind turbine manufacturers as well. And that total investment was about $400 million. According to the latest Chinese plan, offshore wind will certainly become the most dynamic sector in China for the next 10 years, as also Jorge and Gabriel mentioned, that definitely will be one of the hottest areas in China for the next 5 years. Because China, one of the main reasons why China is very keen on developing offshore wind, later I will illustrate in another slide, is because The load center of China electricity is along the coastal regions, while the most of the wind farms, I mean most of the wind resources, are located in northeast, northwest, and also north. Therefore, Chinese government tries to promote the development of offshore wind that are pretty close to the load centers, therefore would not heavily rely on the high voltage transmission line. So you can see on this map, China, some provincial governments have developed more aggressive plans for offshore wind development. According to their current plan, about 17 gigawatts to be developed in next 4 years. You can see Jiangsu province, the coastal province that very close to Shanghai, and also Shandong province. Those two provinces have the most aggressive plan to develop offshore wind. Those coastal regions, as I mentioned before, is a load center for China electricity system. And I'll also show you another slide. And China first offshore concession bidding was held last year, and the four projects were all in Jiangsu province, and adding up to 1 gigawatt capacity. And also, by the way, just add on that point. As I mentioned before, China is building a lot of nuclear reactors. Most of the nuclear reactors are also built along the coast. in order to fulfill the increasing energy demand. Future offshore concessions will likely have much higher entry barriers than the first one I mentioned, the first one that is very close in Shanghai. Because project size, the minimum size for concession will be at least 500 megawatt. And likely it's recommended by the government for each project to have about an expansion plan to reach 1 gigawatt. And also for wind turbine unit capacity, government recommended that the minimum size for wind turbine for intertidal zone. Intertidal zone means that the zone that is between river and also near offshore and the sea would be 2 megawatt, and also for offshore project likely be 3 megawatt minimum, and per four for 5 megawatts. So that would increase the entry barriers for all the market players. For the implication for wind farm developer would be that they need a higher capital raising capabilities. They needed to have better wind source developing capability, and also require stronger operation and maintenance capabilities. That would also impact on the wind turbine manufacturers. Wind turbine manufacturers needed to produce larger, more complex turbine and a better anti corrosion technology. And I recently visited several factories of wind turbine manufacturing in China, including the plant run by, I probably world largest wind turbine manufacturer, RM, a Danish company. They are increasingly establishing their manufacturing footprint in China in order to capture the opportunity in offshore wind. And also has an impact on the installation service providers. They needed to have larger installation ships and also have the experienced team. As you can see from this slide, major Chinese wind turbine manufacturers needed to improve their capabilities to independently develop a large offshore turbines. Nowadays, most of the Chinese wind turbine manufacturers are co-designed, all, you know, establish their capabilities through merger acquisitions, but moving forward, they needed to more independently develop their offshore wind turbines. Currently, China offshore installation capability, I would say, are far behind global leading players, as you can see from this slide. The leading Chinese installation ship company cannot compete with Danish counterparts in terms of the capacity of the crane and their working depths, and also low capacity. This area right now, some Chinese enterprises are trying to catch up. Offshore developers have sought alliance with service providers in order to secure quality offshore services and also ship resources. As you can see from this slide, Guodian Longyuan, Guodian is also one of the largest top five Chinese power generation companies. Longyuan is their subsidiaries with a focus on wind, have set up a GW with a Chinese, one of the largest Chinese heavy industry players to jointly develop their offshore capabilities. So next move, heading overseas. About 5 years ago, when we provided the services to our multinational wind players in China, at that time, likely they represent about at least 50% market share in China. Now, foreign companies are dramatically losing their shares to Chinese players. As you can see from this slide, Chinese OEMs, I mean the largest Chinese wind turbine manufacturers, have increased their global market share from about 1% in 2005 to about 35% this year. And last week when I talked to some professors at HBS, they mentioned to me that the Chinese solar manufacturers are now representing about 70% world market share. So they are also foresee the similar market share increase from Chinese players in the wind sector. Chinese domestic wind turbine manufacturing right now is highly competitive because the tier one companies are representing about 72% market share, but there are still about 60 to 65 small medium-sized players all competing in this market. And also there are new entrants backed up by the fund from PE firms, VC firms, to aggressively enter into the market as well. And the overcapacity now is a serious issue in wind manufacturing as well as in the solar assembly areas. So due to the oversupply reason, the domestic wind turbine price dropped about 50% over the past 3 years, pushing Chinese OEMs to look for new markets abroad, because we are a strategic consulting firm. We were originally hired by some Chinese wind turbine manufacturers to help them to look for the other alternative growth markets for them to capture global market share for them. When Chinese wind turbine manufacturers go abroad, they have two key advantages. One is a low cost. As you can see from this slide, their average cost is lower than their peers in US and Europe. And also, most important these days, they got a strong financing capability through work together with Chinese development banks. That's also one of the arguments I heard from a lot of US utility companies. They complain about the Chinese players try to leverage their financing capability to capture the market in the US. You can see Sinovel, the largest Chinese wind turbine manufacturers, have taken several steps in global markets in the US, Europe, and South Africa, but they do realize that US is the most difficult market for them to enter for the time being. That's the reason why they're gradually move their focus to Europe and their South Africa, and also Latin America. Similarly, Goldwind, another Chinese leading players, actually has been selling its wind turbine in the US. We also further expanded the business into Africa in the years to come. Similarly, you can see other major Chinese players also actively preparing to enter into other market, and they also set up their R&D centers in Europe by teaming up with some technology providers. And by the way, I need to mention that because last week when I discussed that with a bunch of Harvard Business School professors and also CEOs from US utility company like Duke Energy, they all have some misunderstanding, misperception about the Chinese companies. They always think that a Chinese company presumably leverage on their low cost and also financing capability to compete in US market. But probably in the next 5 to 10 years, they will also face a competition from Chinese companies that will enter into renewable energy companies by leveraging their very strong technology know-how. You may not know that the Chinese aviation and aerospace company, the company has a technology to launch satellite, to launch the space into the air, have already entered into solar and wind sectors. They have thousands of engineers are working on renewable energy technologies. So probably they will also, you know, be fierce competitors for European and U.S. Players in the next 5 years in terms of technology development. The challenges and upgrade. Right now, Chinese wind technology is still facing some technical bottlenecks, particularly in the grid connections, and also there are some quality issues for made in China turbines. So we see several accidents last year. You can see from the right hand side of this slide, due to some shut off of hundreds of turbines due to quality issue. The vast, you know, areas in the northwest and central China had been seriously affected due to the suddenly shut off of the wind turbine accidents. And the grid is indeed now the one of the biggest bottlenecks for China, because in China, the grid lacks wind power integration and the transmission capability. As I mentioned before, so you can see the load center is located along the coast, and the wind power center is located in the north, northwest, and the average distance between those two centers is beyond 2,000 kilometers. So China has to face that reality. That's the reason why later on I will cover that the Chinese still and China's state grid, the largest Chinese utility company, probably also one of the largest world utility companies, is building the high voltage transmission line to transmit the electricity generated in the west through solar, through wind, to the industry drones along the coast. So the construction of ongoing high voltage long distance transmission lines is planned, and it will help to balance this network. State grid wind power grid integration capacity will grow fivefold over the next 10 years in order to tackle that challenge by setting up a lot of remote areas, by building up a smart grid capabilities, and also building some pump storage stations. The shut off, as I mentioned before, shut off accidents indicated that the Chinese wind power industry in the past several years traded quality for speed, because most of the installed wind turbines like low voltage right through capabilities, and most of the wind farms in operation was not required to have that capabilities. And nowadays the pressure to upgrade already installed wind turbines has been passed on to OEM, because this market in China is really a buyer market. Utilities like State Grid, Southern China Grid, are transferring the pressure onto operators, and operators also transferring the pressure to OEMs. The massive rig construction and upgrades have already been started, because Chinese government can quickly realize some problem and take the reactions also very quick. So they right now forcing wind turbine manufacturers and wind farm operators to apply to the new requirement, and also we think that would provide more opportunities for foreign players that have more sophisticated the LVRT and also integration security capabilities. So due to the time constraint, I just quickly went through those slides, and feel free to ask me any question related to China Wind. Thank you.
I just wanted to ask the panel one quick question. You alluded to this, all of you alluded to this, as sort of markets in the lesser developed countries, and maybe you could comment on where you see the smaller economies going in terms of wind energy development. Is it a viable option?
Well, Gabriel was mentioning before one very important thing, which is that wind farms are being able to be up and running in a very short period of time. So as the GDPs of emerging countries or smaller countries are growing, as though there is a crisis on a worldwide scale, I think that wind, and for those countries that do have the resource, is a viable alternative. We're now looking at places that I would have never dreamt of being there before, like let me give you two examples, one in Asia, which is Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka, as you know, had a very difficult period some years ago with a very severe civil war. And we set up a first wind farm a year ago, and it's basically, now we're onto the second one, and it's basically what is nourishing for electricity, the country. No? And the other one, which is, as we speak, being created right now, is in a place that maybe some of you have never heard of, and the country is called Lesotho. Lesotho is in South Africa. It's just in the middle of South Africa, and we're going to set up there a 35 megawatt wind farm at the highest level ever to create a wind farm, which is 3,200 meters. So, yes, there are opportunities, but you have to become very creative to find places where this is now also possible.
And was that a World Bank financing?
No. This is straight financing from Standard Bank in South Africa. Hmm. Yeah.
Did you want to add something?
No, from my side, I would say that the biggest problem is, from a developer standpoint, your biggest problem is price certainty and creditworthiness of your counterpart in some of these countries. So if I'm going to own the project, I need to have a long-term contract to sell the electricity. As I said, we invest all the capital of a project on day one, and we need to have certainty on the revenue side. Identifying a creditworthy counterpart in those markets is extremely complicated. And then the other reality is that normally those countries do not enjoy the best grid infrastructure of the world. So, I mean, the ability for them to absorb wind is there, but not in big amounts.
Question from the audience?
A 7-second question for Mr. Calvet. May I ask if any of your new clients have tapped into the climate investment funds of the World Bank? Thank you.
From the top of my head, I'm not sure that some of them have done it. To be frank with you, the answer is a 7-second answer. I don't know.
Why is there no energy policy incorporating renewables when Congress recognizes that it's the 800-pound gorilla, that it's the big major issue facing them, and when Congress has been so productive, so unbelievably productive since 2009? Dobbs-Frank, they did the stimulus program, and they did the health care reform. You've been trying that for 40 years. We've got all these things through. So Congress is productive on big issues. Why aren't they on this?
Well, if he has the answer, so because he's living here in the States. But one thing I would like to add on to what you're saying, because I fully agree with you, is this administration and President Obama himself personally has had, has visited us, has visited Gamesa factory in Philadelphia, north of Philadelphia, only a few months ago. So I think that it is not an issue of the administration, because the White House is absolutely committed to wind energy. I think that you have to focus more on Congress and Senate, no, and perhaps more the Senate, but I leave it up to Gabriel to go into the details, because he's fighting with them every day.
I mean, tomorrow, actually, I'm in the White House on Wednesday, meeting with the senior advisor to the White House. And actually, believe it or not, this Saturday I was shopping here in the Fifth Avenue, and I ran into Vice President Joe Biden. He was with his wife in H&M buying, and no one saw him. I actually said, "Mr. Vice President, hello, how are you doing?" With big smile, the whitest teeth I have ever seen. Pretty impressive. Then I look around, and there were three or four guys with, security. But my opinion, there is a few things. There is a structural problem with the way the politics are structured here in the U.S. You have Congress, which is an entity that goes for re-election every 2 years. So when you have the House that goes for re-election for every 2 years, you are running all the time. Your ability to influence politics is minimal. I will be meeting with representatives tomorrow. I've done it last week. I did it 2 or 3 weeks ago. Their fundamental problem is that it's very complicated to make to influence long-term decisions. So that's the structural problem. When you have a body within the approval process that it's going for approval every 2 years. Then I think that a lot of what's happening right now in Washington, it's that there are, I don't know how many, 40 votes from the Tea Party, and I have had meetings with Republicans. I met with Speaker Boehner a month ago. Republicans, primarily on the Republican side, telling us, you know what, the problem is that our political party is voting wherever those guys vote. And those guys don't want to do anything with renewable energy. They have this opinion about climate change and green energy is part of the same boat. They don't want to do anything with that, and we are in no position right now to deal with something that smells and has to do with subsidies. Even if, to be frank, the amount of subsidies that oil and gas business receive, it's much, much higher. I mean, the Environmental Law Institute issued a report between 2002 and 2008, $75 billion of tax credits and direct benefits went to oil and gas businesses, 10 went to renewable energy projects. Okay, so we are talking about huge. The second reality is that those huge companies are influencing the political agenda. You have a business political model where lobbying is legal. Okay, it's very legal, it's very transparent, you know it's happening, so you guys decided to make it legal, which I think honestly is the right way. But the reality is that big corporations influence political agendas. You may not like it, but that's how it works. So right now, the big corporations that are investing billions, hundreds of billions of dollars in shale gas, will not let this system decide on a policy that is leaving room for other sources of electricity that are not gas entering into the mix. Because nuclear clearly is not in the picture with what has happened in Japan, but gas certainly is. So unless they know that if they leave the system as it is, gas will take it over.
Thank you for your very interesting presentation. You know, of course, you have contradictions in this in the United States. T-Bone Pickings has one of the largest natural gas companies in the United States, yet he's the big advocate for wind. So there's that contradiction, and I wanted to know, Americans have experienced the Enron crisis. There's a tremendous opposition locally growing in the United States to fracking. This state is a good example of it. How do you think that's going to play out on this? Because T-Bone Pickings, of course, is self-interested in pushing wind, very bluntly. And, one has to sort of query this. You know, what do you make of those contradictions? That you have a guy who's like a big natural gas producer, yet he's the big pusher for wind.
Okay. T-Bone Pickens is supporting energy independence. So his main mantra is we need to source our electricity from national sources of electricity. That's why he supports wind. He failed with his project. He had a big, big project in Texas. He may be very good with gas development. he made a mistake and he couldn't build his project. And it's funny because now the guys on the right side, when I look at, when I watch Bill O'Reilly or Fox News, they always point to that examples to claim how wind doesn't work because Steven Pickens failed, like he was perfect. So he made a mistake, it doesn't work. The reality right now is that what Steven Pickens is doing is something that, in my opinion, makes structural sense for the US, which is advocating for developing the optionality to be energy independent. The amount of wealth that is leaving this country, going to the wrong places in many cases, but setting aside where that money goes is gigantic. We're talking about hundreds of billions of dollars every year to buy oil and gas from the same countries that are not necessarily friendly to the US. So I think what he is doing is goes beyond the energy sector. It's about macroeconomics, it's about geopolitical environment. So there are contradictions. I think there are contradictions. But I think what you are is there, I don't think Steven Pickens has a hidden agenda. He wants to make money, which is fine. If you can make money out of wind, I'm trying to make money out of wind. It's not easy. Jorge is trying to. We are not a business of ponytails and flip-flops anymore. We are a real business. So it's good to make money. And he was trying to make it with wind. He failed. He's still a billionaire with all the money he made with gas. So.
I just had a quick question. Since it's not ponytails and flip-flops anymore, these SIPA students that are here are finishing their programs, do you see this as a growth area for students graduating from these kind of programs?
Yeah, I mean, we have an internship program that we launched when EDP bought Horizon. Actually, Goldman didn't have it, and we implemented an internship program every year. And that program has been an amazing source of new infrastructure within our company, and it has been a great source of people to our company. I mean, we hire people from that internship program every year. So it's one, to be frank, is one of the cheapest way to identify talent in this country, and one of the cheapest way to build infrastructure. You have a lot of initiative, there is a huge amount of workload every day, and the team doesn't have the ability to deal with ways to improve what they are doing. They all wait for the 8 weeks in the summer to hire interns to make sure that during those 8 weeks they can build that infrastructure, which is really helping us.
And Gamesa?
Well, I'll give you one piece of data. No? In the last 18 months, we've hired 2,000 people. So if you think that there is no hope for this industry or no future, I can assure you that we would not have hired that amount of employees. No? And we keep on hiring. I think that that this industry has a tremendous future. I hope that it is, because of the politicians, as I said before, it's not my grandchildren who will see the explosive growth that this industry is going to have, that we will see it hopefully within the next 2 to 3 years. But yeah, I have absolutely no doubts that this is big time growth.
And consulting?
Yes, you know, Roland Berger is now number two in China, just you know, after McKinsey. We are now hiring about 50 to 70 people every day, most of them from the U.S. universities. That's really why I'm also here. And we also hire several Columbia graduates. Some of them actually are American, working on our Hong Kong office to serve renewable energies in Greater China area.
Sorry, what's on, you said 70 per day?
No. We recruit 50 to 70 people for China offices every year. Pretty big recruitment plan for consulting firms.
I used to work for a congresswoman in the Great Plains of Colorado, and we used to get a lot of calls from constituents asking when the grid would come to them so that they could build a wind farm. So I have sort of a two-part question. What is your land mix in terms of what you own and versus what's leased? And then, and maybe that changes depending on what country you're working in. And then secondarily, what do you do when there's not an infrastructure to support electricity from wind turbines? Do you not go into those markets, or how do you deal with it? Thanks.
So in terms of the US, 99.9% of the land where we have turbines is leased. We don't own the land. We are given the space between turbines. Actually, we are not even, we are a secondary source of revenues for landowners. I mean, they keep farming their land. They actually have, now that you build roads to access the turbines, they love it because it really helps them more efficiently farming their property. So we don't lease it. We don't own it. We just lease it. The only country where this is an exception is Romania, okay, where we owned land in Romania. And this is a similar situation as with Greece. In Romania as well as in Greece, believe it or not, there are not very good records of who owns what land. That's because the Turks invaded controlled those countries for many, many years, and they actually ended up disregarding properties, and that property became part of the empire. Of course, local landowners, they know exactly what piece of land they own. But so in order to have the right guarantees and get the financing you need in those countries, we would actually own the property and buy the property. The second question is, what happens if there is no infrastructure? We don't have the grid to support. Well, if you don't have the grid to support the development of wind, you cannot deliver the electricity you produce. Normally, and this is a reality in this country, the wind resource is not exactly where the load, where the demand, and where people live. We are getting closer and closer as the technology is improving. We talked about it. But we need transmission infrastructure. So you always need to have infrastructure in place to deliver the electricity you produce. If it doesn't exist, then you will go to the local utility. If the local utility is planning to build that transmission line over a key period of time, then you may decide to develop a project there. But normally, if I don't have if I don't have the infrastructure, I won't build it. You were mentioning you are from you work with representatives south of Colorado, correct?
West or
east. Well, actually, we have a big project in Baca County. We have a huge amount of land leased, 100,000 acres, and we have been waiting for 5 years to Xcel Energy build the transmission line. They told us 5 years ago they would build. We went all the way there, leased a bunch of land, and we are still waiting.
I think that's the calls I was getting.
Okay. Can I, excuse me, just something important, if I may add to what Gabriel was just saying. Do you know how many people in the world do not have any access to electricity? Ballpark figure? Any takers?
I know the answer.
1.6 billion. So it's 1,600 million people who have no access to electricity, which I think it's a shame because electricity is the main driver for economic growth. So what I fully subscribe what Gabriel has been saying, but we have gone a step beyond, and what we're looking now are at our what we call off-grid systems. We do believe strongly that we can provide renewable energy, both solar and wind, to way off communities, and for that reason we have bought a company here in the States who is doing precisely that. It was doing it for the U.S. Army, and we have moved on from doing it for the U.S. Army to the most out-of-path village that you can imagine in India, for example. No? And it's becoming a very, very big and significant opportunity for us.
I think we're going to have just time for one more question. So you have the last question.
My question is about the challenges in localization of international wind turbine manufacturers. I know that especially for Gamesa going to Chinese market is a challenge, because I remember last year the government saying something like we require a certain percentage of wind turbines manufactured inside China, not imported. So my question is about when you going global to the to a specific local garment market, you'll encounter some challenges like for example, in China, the local producers will receive very low interest loans and very cheap lands from the government. So how do you make yourself more competitive in the local market? Thank you.
It's a Chinese question.
$1 million.
It's a very good question. Well, look, in China, you have to become very creative, no? And about 2 years ago, we were only in the business of selling turbines to our customers, which were the big utilities, Longjiang, Guadian, Guangdong Nuclear, etc. But we saw that was not a real
long-term proposal or proposition, so we decided to think what else we could do to be competitive. And one of the main challenges that the Chinese utilities had was that they were not, they didn't have the capacity to grow as much as they were suggested by the government, by the regulators to grow. So we told them, look, we have a business model where we not only manufacture wind turbines, but we develop wind farms for our customers on a worldwide basis. So why don't we use that capacity, that capability, to help you develop wind farms? And after 2 years, we remain a partner of yours for 2 years, and after 2 years, we sell the wind farm to you. No? So we have done that, and we have right now, with this program, about a pipeline of about 6,000 megawatts on joint venture basis with Chinese utilities. And obviously also, in order to be able to do so, what we have done also is to create small assembly factories in places like, probably you will know, in Jilin province, and also in Inner Mongolia, which are the provinces that have some of the highest wind resources in China. No? So by doing that, we have been able to secure, through the local government, wind resources, i.e. megawatts, where we will develop jointly with our customers. So that is one thing. And the other thing that we're doing, it's a step further, is we're helping also these utilities to go abroad. So in a way, they can look at Gamesa as a global portfolio of opportunities for the development of wind business in China and abroad. And by doing the foreign issue now, the foreign development, we're also able to consolidate our presence in China. The other thing I wanted to say, it has also been very important from a manufacturing point of view that we have developed a comprehensive and very efficient supplier base or local supplier base. No? We have in China, out of the six factories that we have, four are in Tianjin, and around our factories in Tianjin, we have created a supplier base of 120 companies. So that has made us, from a cost point of view, as efficient as any Chinese manufacturer. Okay.
Does EDP have anything in China?
No. From a development standpoint, developing projects in China, it's a very competitive market. So we don't have right now a real advantage versus local players. I mean, local knowledge or ability to work around the net of bureaucracy and decision-making process within China is critical, and we don't have that expertise.
So I think we'll wrap up, and I want to say thank you to Mr. Alonso. Thank you for coming. Mr. Calvet, thank you. And Mr. Liu, I think it has been a very interesting and engaging discussion, and I think we all really learned a lot. So thank you for hosting this conference.